And then lastly, this is the tough one. We lost a friend this week who not only was one of the finest character actors working in motion pictures and television, but it was a really good guy and a friend to Kevin. He knew him very well, and I knew him as well because we had a chance to work together a little bit. His name was Michael Parks, and he passed away this week. And it was hard. It was hard. Michael was 77 years old this week, and he was a favorite of Quentin Tarantino's, Robert Rodriguez.
That's how I found him. It was 1995 when From Dusk Till Dawn was about to come out. Bob Weinstein had a screening at the Lemley. He's like, you want to go see Quentin and Rabbit's new movie? That's what he sounds like. And I said, yeah, fucking the vampire thing? Fuck, that sounds good. So I went for the Quentin and Robert vampire movie that George Clooney was in and stuff. Although I didn't watch ER, so I wasn't like, holy fuck, Clooney.
Right.
But I knew he was making the jump to movies and stuff. So I went in for all these other elements. And then in the first 5 minutes sitting there, first 5 to 10 minutes, the opening of that movie, Michael Parks comes in and drops this fucking performance that is spellbinding. Like, suddenly, you're like, holy shit, that's the realest fucking person I've ever seen in a movie. Like, he just stole the fucking show. And, you know, that show hadn't even begun. And the show is pretty impressive. From Dusk Till Dawn captures your imagination. But mine had been captured in the first few minutes. And the rest of the movie, all I could think about is, like, who is that fucking guy? I don't know who that is. That was amazing. And I said to Scott Mosier, my producer, who I do Smodcast with still, I literally said out loud, I was like, could you imagine what it'd be like to work with an acting Yoda like that? Like, that dude's forgotten more about performance than we'll ever fucking know. Fuck, that was amazing and shit. I said, I want to work with that guy one day. And it took me 15 years of a career, because I never felt like I could call him up and be like, hey man, do you want to play Silent Bob's grandpa? Or anything like that.
Right.
So when I wanted to make Red State, he was the guy that I thought of, and he was the dude that I kind of championed and kind of went after. And I remember he came over to the house, and I met with him, and you know, I told him how fucking, like, look, I think you're amazing, and I love you and all, Quentin stuff, and I got this part where you play kind of like, you know, like the Westboro Baptist Church, but if they were really crazy and had guns and stuff, like a killer preacher. And he goes, oh, killer preacher, huh? I've been waiting my whole life to do this. And he fucking treated it more seriously than I think anybody that I've ever worked with has treated a part that they had. He choreographed everything, like when, you know, he knew exactly where he was gonna be at every point in the sermon. He was a true master of his craft, and watching him fucking work was spellbinding. The dude brought out the best in me, and like, it was crushing to hear that he passed away, because the entire second act of my career has been predicated on Michael's back. Like, I don't do Red State unless there's a Michael Parks. It's the only reason I could write that movie, because I was like, I know a guy who could pull this off. And then after Red State, like, you know, I didn't work for like 3 years. I was like, I don't want to make movies anymore. And we did the TV show and podcasting and stuff like that. And then Tusk came out of an episode of Smodcast. And so when I went back, when, like, I didn't want to do films anymore and stuff, I was like, it was wonderful, but like, how much more can I do? Like, I did everything. I did way more than I ever wanted to do, so I'm good. But the moment that I was like, I might want to go back and try a movie again, the fucking first person that came into my head was Parks. And I had this crazy story about a guy who's going to try to turn another guy into a walrus, and I was like, oh my God, Parks would crush at that and stuff. So I reached out to him, and again, he was the bridge to like my second act. Now, some people don't like those movies, and they're like Red State and fucking and Tusk and Yoga Hosers is Kevin going off the rails and he's lost it and shit like that. But as a true, like, hardcore Kevin Smith fan, maybe the biggest Kevin Smith fan in the world, I love those movies, and those movies don't happen without Michael Parks.
Yeah.
So it was tough, man, to hear that news. He was old, you know, Michael was 77.
He had some health issues.
And he'd had some health issues, but like, he was the guy. I remember when we were making, if you've ever seen Red State, the movie ends with Parks in a cell, kind of like crazily praying out loud to himself, quasi singing a little bit and shit. He's reciting this religious poem song that he had written himself. And so that's how we were going to go out. And Michael goes, I really think you should change it. I said, yeah. And he goes, yeah, like this guy's been talking the whole fucking movie. I think what you need is you roll down from his cell to another guy's cell and you see another guy in jail. And he's in an orange jumpsuit. And then he says, shut the fuck up. And the movie ends. I said, oh, okay. I guess, yeah, that'd be one way to do it. And he goes, but you should play that guy. And I was like, really? Me? Why? And he goes, because you wrote all this. So, like, it'd be funny if you were the one saying, shut the fuck up. And the movie ended. It's like saying, cut. And I was like, oh, I get it. I said, well, that sounds fun, but the only problem is if I do that, people are going to be distracted. Like, I'll pull them out of the movie. We've had them in this whole different world, and then they're going to see me, and suddenly they're, you know, fucking, they're going to be like, oh, it's fucking him and shit. And Parks looks at me, like, baffled. And he's like, why would anybody know who the fuck you are? And I was like, what do you mean? He's like, how would anyone recognize, who's going to recognize you, your mother? And I said, oh, I've been in movies.
I've made some other films.
I've been in movies. And he goes, like what? And I listed the movies. He goes, I never heard of those. He said, what are you doing them? I said, I play a character called Silent Bob. And he goes, do you talk? And I go, no, Silent Bob. And he goes, well, if you don't talk, you're not acting. So, you know, he was such a, like, a straightforward, on Front Street, I've lived it all. Like, you couldn't really impress him because he'd known impressive
people.
He had
been everywhere and done everything. When you sit back and listen to the guy's stories, he would tell you about Sinatra and hanging out and drinking with Robert Mitchum and Elvis Presley.
Or he'd talk about, he'd be
Miles Davis.
I was over Martin's house and blah, blah, blah. And you're like, oh, Martin Sheen? And he's like, Martin Sheen, talk about Martin Luther King. And you're like, what? You know, he was one of Lenny Bruce's pallbearers. One of Johnny Cash's best friends.
Yeah.
Like, he had this huge fucking life. He worked with John Huston on the Bible. He told us that Huston tried to kill him. Like, he was fond of that story. He's like, John Huston tried to kill me on the Bible. I was like, oh, he worked you too hard? He goes, no, he literally tried to kill me with his own hands.
Yeah.
And then drowned me on the set. And I was like, are you shitting me? He goes, yeah, movies were tougher then. I was like, so I guess I'm okay as a director. I haven't tried to kill you yet. He's like, yeah, but Huston got a great performance out of me. So he was like, my favorite moment, I think I was thinking about it when he passed, because, you know, you try to think of, like, the best things, the best moments and shit. And it came in post on Red State, because when the movie was done and we'd taken it to Sundance and stuff and we were going to take it out on tour. You know, Quentin was the guy who fucking loved Parks. Like, that's the only reason he wound up in From Dusk Till Dawn, because Quentin was telling Robert, you gotta cast this guy, Michael Parks. He's amazing. He was in a TV show, then came Bronson, like, blah, blah, blah. So it's because of Quentin, and Quentin used him again and again as Earl McGraw and
Kill Bill.
James Parks as his son, Kill Bill, and also the Grindhouse movies. So Quentin loved him, and he loved Quentin in a big, bad way. So Quentin heard about Red State, and he was like, you got to come up and show me the movie. Like, he's got a theater at his house and stuff. He's like, bring a print. We'll watch the movie. And I was like, oh, my God, yeah. And, you know, that was like Quentin, my favorite filmmaker on the planet. The movie was very Quentin-esque. To watch it with him was going to be a cool thing. So I talked to Parks. I was like, I'm going to watch the movie at Quentin's. He goes, I want to go. And I was like, I think he'd love that because he's a huge fucking Michael Parks fan. So I asked Quentin. He's like, oh, my God, yeah, bring him. This is going to be cool. And then we get to his place, and we watch the movie together, all of us in the screening room. It's just three of us. And if you ever want to feel good about anything you've ever done in your life, share it with a very stoned Quentin Tarantino. Because he's the kind of guy who's, like, literally sitting in his own theater going, like, it's like this movie was made for me, man. And it was made for him. Like, he was kind of the core audience. But he was sitting there verbally appreciating Michael's performance to Michael while Michael was in the room during the movie. Quentin's a very enthusiastic movie watcher. So he'd be like, oh, you're a genius. And then go back to watching the movie and shit. And he would say that to Parks, and Parks would beam and shit. So the movie was done, and he's just fucking blowing, like, Parks. It's beautiful to watch, because Parks is, he respects the fuck out of Quentin. So to hear that guy be like, oh my God, Michael, I've watched, you know, I know your body of work.
Right.
And that is like you off the charts and blah, blah, blah. And he goes, come, you guys got to come in the house with me. So he takes us into the house. And in the house, he brings us into the living room. This big ass fucking TV. And he's got a bunch of media playing units. So he's, you know, he's a DVD player, of course, and a Blu-ray player. But he also still had his VHS hooked up. He still had Laserdisc player hooked up. And I'm pretty sure I saw Betacam hooked up as well. So he pulls out, there's a stack of VHS tapes right in front of the TV. Like, I thought I went back in time. Because I was like, holy shit, he's still got VHS going. And he pulls out a fucking tape, and he's like, look at this. I got to show you this. And it's essentially, it says, Michael Parks, Volume 2. And Quentin pops in this tape and shows me the scene from this volleyball movie. I think it was called Spiked or something. And it was a TV movie about kids, teen volleyball scene, high school. And, you know, it's like you're watching the scene going, this is fucking cheese. Why are we watching this and shit? Then Parks walks into the scene as the coach. And all of a sudden, like, the whole thing flips. And you're like, oh, my God, this is the most gripping thing I've ever seen.
Yeah.
I got to see this teen volleyball movie and shit. So he's like, Michael, I've watched this scene so many times. This movie's terrible. And then you walk in and you light it on fire. And he goes, that's just one. Let me fast forward to another. What Quentin would do was go through the like TV guide, and anytime he saw like a Michael Parks performance in a late night show, like 3 a.m., they're going to run fucking, you know, J. Edgar Hoover files or whatever fuck he was in. He would set his VCR to record it. And then he would take that tape and take all the Michael Parks scenes and just tape those onto a separate tape. So he was showing us Volume 2 of his, like, Michael Parks' greatest hits tape.
It was a clip reel.
A clip reel that he had collected over the course of his life and still fucking had at the ready. Hmm. So the greatest moment of Red State for me wasn't, like, watching Michael crush, like, on set, which was amazing. Taking that dialogue and fucking elevating it. Like, had no idea anyone could act that fucking brilliantly, that convincingly. But it was that moment watching the genius that is Quentin praising the genius that is Michael Parks as they sat there and watched Michael's old filmography together. Mm. Like, you know, I always dreamed about maybe getting Parks nominated for that movie. And we tried. We had a fucking 1 week qualifying screening at Quentin's Theater and stuff because you need to have a theatrical run of a week long. You know, and when we had it, people were like, this is fucking pie in the sky. But he deserved it. His performance was like so fucking good. Like, if it had been another filmmaker, he probably would have gotten nominated and shit. But honestly, I don't think, like, he won an award at the Sitges Film Festival for that movie, for playing that role. But I honestly don't feel anything for him was better than that fucking night. Like, I watched a 72-year-old man turn into a fucking 12-year-old kid. He was gleeful. As the other guy, who's always fucking gleeful, particularly when it comes to cinema, was just sitting here coming off of watching his performance and honoring him by being like, let's watch the rest of your body of work. And
right.
We sat there for hours watching clips of Michael. It was like such a magical, special evening. That's the Parks that I always like to think about. And of course on Tusk. Like, this is a long story, but it's a really good story. He, on Tusk, first week of the show, he was different than he was on Red State. Like, he seemed kind of, well, it had been a few years, at least 3, maybe 4 years at that point. But he seemed a little different. Josh, who, you know, does our needle drop here, our mix master, was kind of the Parks valet. Came to North Carolina, and so I was like, you're on Michael, get him to and from the set. And they became friends. Once you hung out with Michael, he was a guy that you could sit there and talk to, and he was fucking fascinating and shit. So we're going to, we're doing Tusk. First week, him and Justin, like Justin's super friendly and stuff. We're doing all the stuff with them in the house. And Michael doesn't really like warm up to Justin, doesn't really talk to him. Justin's like, hey, how are you, man? I can't wait to do this and stuff. And he's just like, Really like giving him the cold shoulder. Like 3-4 days into the show, like 3 days in, like, you know, Justin at one point was kind of upset about it. He's like, what am I doing wrong? He's going, you've worked with the guy. And I was like, maybe he thinks that's good for the role or something like that because you play antagonists or whatever. So it's our last day of the first week, and we're doing the scene, if you've ever seen the movie, where Justin finds out he's got no leg. and Michael's character's in a wheelchair, and he's feeding him this weird story about you got bit by a spider, and so a doctor had to take your leg off. And Justin's reaction, like in our blocking rehearsal, Justin kind of showed us what he was going to do in the scene. And, you know, it's fucking manic, but it's also funny. So, like, Justin's like, my leg is missing, and he's getting real big. And Parks, who is like, you know, been fucking stern the whole show, like, all of a sudden starts giggling and cracking up and shit. So I was like, what's funny, Michael? And he's going, this fucking scene is crazy. He's going, his leg's missing, and I tell him it's because of a spider? This is so fucking stupid, you know? He was charmed by how dopey the scene was, but it was more than that. Like, I could tell he was reacting to Justin. Like, Justin's performance, he couldn't help himself. And Michael was a master fucking thespian, but he couldn't help but laugh. He found it really funny. So I go to Justin, I was like, look, man, lean into that shit. When we do the take, just try to make him laugh. Like, get as big as you can. He goes, really? I was like, yeah, because when he fucking laughs and tries to spit out dialogue, it is creepy. So fucking let's do it. And so Justin leaned into it, and Michael couldn't get through. Like, it took us about 10 minutes to get through the take because Michael was just laughing and then laughing through the dialogue and then trying to compose himself. And then periodically he would like yell out to try to clear his head. But then he would start laughing again the moment Justin started like talking and stuff. So by the end of that take, like, Michael was like crying, just like having a blast, enjoying himself. Not just thinking about the work, but like, wow, that was fun. And the next thing I saw was him and Justin out on the smoking porch having a cigarette and fucking talking. And for the rest of the show, all he would ever talk about is like, that Justin Long is going to win an Oscar one day. Mm. He's going, I like that kid a lot. Like, they fell in love with each other.
That's
now,
great.
That was the story I told you just to tell you this story. When the show was over, we left North Carolina and stuff. Michael went home. And I spoke to his son, James, who plays his son in Quentin's movies. Like, you know, the guy, and his son number one, like, that's his son, James. So James goes, Kev, I want to tell you something we didn't tell you before the show, but I think it's important that you know. I said, what is it? And he goes, right before you called about this Tusk movie, Dad had had a health episode, stroke-like thing, that kind of knocked him out, brain out of whack, like wasn't making sense anymore, talking about dates that didn't exist and stuff like that. He's like, so, but he wanted to go do the movie. When he was clear about that. So we sent him to North Carolina, and fingers crossed. And when we got him back at the end of the show, he sounded like Dad from before the accident, before the stroke. And I said, what do you think that was? And he's going, I honestly think that it was having to do all that dialogue was brain rehab, the way like a doctor would work you out your body parts. First he had to memorize, like, because there were pages of monologues that he had to do. But he said, but also it was the camaraderie of being with other actors and being treated like the fucking pro he was. Michael didn't work nearly as much as he probably could have and should have.
Yeah.
But on that set, everyone, like Genesis, Haley, Justin, would just sit there and listen to him as he talked about his life, about his theory, drink with him, hang out with him. And they brought him back. So the kids didn't know that. I never told them that. And so after Michael passed the other day, we were texting and doing a circle between me and Justin and Haley and Genesis. And I told them that story. And Justin was like, I had no idea that reframes the entire first week. And I was like, yeah, dude, he was drowning. And y'all literally fucking brought that dude back to shore with the work. Like, because that's what Michael loved the most in life. Was the work. He didn't come into acting like, wasn't born into it. He had real jobs and was a real human being and came to acting late in life, but was insanely fucking good at it and stuff and really believed in the craft. It was a beyond crushing blow, even though he was 77 years old. And yes, you know, old people age out and die, and I get that, but he could have been around for a few more years, man, if he hadn't, he'd had a fall a little while ago. But that was a really fucking tough one. I spent the other day just bawling my eyes out, going like, fuck, why didn't I do more and blah, blah, blah. But James sent me a very nice message by way of Josh that, like, at the end, Michael was still talking about Red State and stuff. And I remember you guys, like, hanging out during the show. Like, you hung out with him, would pal around. That was when you were smoking cigarettes. And spent quality time with the fucking dude. And he liked you. Like, I remember when we did Tusk, he's like, how's Garmy? And I said, Garmy's coming back. I said, he's going to be in this. He plays a role. He's one of the guys that send the kids to you. And he's going, I like that guy. Good smoker. So you let him down by quitting smoking, motherfucker. Yeah,
it was funny because I didn't work with him on Tusk. I only came in for a couple of days to do a little thing, and then I left. But when he heard I was in town, he hunted me down, and he called me in my room, and he said, where are you? And I said, I'm in my room. He said, come to my room. And so we came, and we hung out for a while. And I was only there for like 2 days. But we reconnected because we had spent a ton of time together on the set of Red State. And I got up to leave the next day to fly out from North Carolina back to L.A., and then my message thing was blinking. And I checked the message, and the message at the front desk was, Mr. Parks said, don't leave without having breakfast with him. And I called him at the room, and he was up and dressed and ready and showered, and he said, come on, I'm going to take you to breakfast. And we went down to the lobby, and we ate together before I left, because he said, I didn't want to let you leave without hanging out with you. And that's the kind of guy he was. He was a sweet, sweet man. And he loved actors, and he loved, like you mentioned, the company of other actors. And I'll never forget the times I spent with him. We hung out quite a bit, and it was really special. So
Genesis told me that on her last day, he made her waffles. So he liked her more than you. Yeah, he was, I saw somebody in a movie once and like made a dopey wish about like, fuck, I want to work with that guy. And it took me a while and I got to do with it. I got to have my dream come true. And the motherfucker was so much better than I thought he would be. And I was prepared, but he was so fucking wonderful and fucking warm. I will miss him every day of my life. There's like three things that I had for him to do that he won't now, of course, get to do. But that's my loss, and that's selfish. I've been thinking a lot about death because of Michael this week, and I was just like, you know, it's really about the living. Like, Michael's done. Like, his fight is over and shit. He doesn't have to worry about where the next job's coming from. He's at peace. Like, it's all of us that have to stick around and go, like, how do you function without that fucking guy in your life? It's difficult, man.
But to your credit, and...
I don't want to talk about that. I know, I know. Everyone's been saying that. They're like, you put him in stuff, but it's just like, it doesn't matter. Like,
no, the guy didn't work nearly as much as he should have, and he didn't have the career that he could have, but I'm just happy for him that he had two roles that he really could roll around in and have a good time doing, and that was significant to him, and it doesn't make up for the loss of him, but it's a nice gift that you were able to give him.
It was vice versa.
Yeah, no, I mean, look, you give and you get.
Like, in order to work with that guy, I have to step up my game. And I know some people like step up your game. Those movies are fucking batshit terrible. But no, that's how I got to Michael. Like, Michael liked weird shit. He wasn't gonna like Jay and Silent Bob Strike Back. And Michael was the bridge to Johnny. Like, Johnny said yes to Tusk because he was like, Parks is in this. I get to act with him. I love that guy. It's like I was watching him when I was a kid on Then Came Bronson.
Yeah.
So Parks was a gift that just always fucking gave. John Goodman said yes to the movie because he's like, Michael Parks is playing this preacher? I'm fucking in. So, yeah, it was a, I don't know.
As we say goodbye, speaking of John Goodman, there's a scene in Red State, one of my favorite moments in the film, and I'm biased, of course, but I really enjoy that film enormously. And there's a scene at the end where... the preacher has come out of his compound and the four horsemen of the apocalypse are ready to be unleashed on the planet because that horn, Gabriel's horn, is blowing, and he confronts Goodman's character at the in this moment in the film. It's one of my favorites. So I thought as we say goodbye to Michael, we'd take a look at this moment from Red State.
No more fire and brimstone, preacher! What does that sound mean?
Well, boy, there ain't nothing left but fire and brimstone. Can't you hear? Can't you hear? It's the Lord's day of judgment. Four trumpet blasts, the seals have been opened, and the horsemen dispatched. Three more blasts, and he closes the book on this wicked, wicked war. Praise his name. So come on. Come on, G-Man. G for godless. G for government. Come on. Come on, shoot me. Shoot me, you boot-licking, flag-worshipping heathen. Shoot me. It only hastens my reward in eternity. Shoot me. Shoot me. Shoot me. Shoot me!
Huge cauldron of wind, yeah. Michael Parks, man. He will be...